We should start the second talk, and I would like to invite Jacob Christiansen. His talk title is Chebyshev Polynomials in the Complex Plane.
Thank you very much. Let me just see if I can share a screen. I'm the co-host, so I should be able to do that. Okay. Can you see it? I think you
Yes,
you can.
Very good.
Perfect. Yeah. Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Sergey. And first of all, of course, I would like to thank the organizers. It's great to see so many people that I know well. Again, of course, I would have loved to be in Sochi, but the circumstances are complicated still. Hopefully, next time. And I also want to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk about my work. So the topic is really very classical, Chebyshev polynomials. It's what I will talk about is based on joint work with Barry Simon and Maxim Sinchenko. If I had been on the real line, I would also have included Yuditsky, but Peter shouldn't really be held responsible for some of the wrong conjectures we had in the complex plane. Along the way, you will also see some pictures because I will also discuss joint work in progress with my student in Lund, Olof Rubin. Okay, so let's get started. Just make this smaller. Okay. So yes, the polynomials that we will consider has already been defined more or less in the talk of Totic and also Yuditsky. In a way, I want to go as general as I possibly can. So take any compact set in the complex plane, infinite, or I want it to be non-polar positive capacity. And those monic polynomial of degree n that minimizes the subnorm on the set, that's the Chebyshev polynomials. Good. So those we want to consider. And a little bit of notation, when you see an omega from time to time, that's not the complement of E, but the unbounded component of the complement. Often it is actually complement because from time to time I will fill in the set E and assume that it's polynomially convex. By the maximum principle, of course, there's no difference between the sup on the set and the polynomial convex. So what will I study for these sequences of polynomials? Two things, and I hope to get to both of them, but let's start by the zeros. So I want to understand how the zeros of these polynomials behave. And I also want to discuss the approximation error, so that's the norm of the polynomials. Okay, so let's start out with something very simple. The two examples where everything is known. First one is the circle or the disk. Polynomials are just c to the n and the norms are one. So all the zeros are situated at zero, of course. The other example is the interval. Then you have the classical Chebyshev polynomials of the first kind. Hopefully I normalized them in the right way. So that's just this cosine n theta. And here the norm is two. And if you look at the zeros and you go up to higher and higher degree, they will accumulate at equilibrium on the interval. Okay, now the second example can be lifted. So already Faber realized that you can lift this to also apply for ellipses. So here I just parameterize the ellipse. And it turns out that these polynomials that are Chebyshev for the interval are also Chebyshev for ellipses. And I will actually in the talk go a little bit further because not only for one interval, but for several intervals with certain properties, you can lift this. But unfortunately, or not for all degrees. Okay. So what I want to do is I want to do basically two things. I want to be as general as I possibly can, of course, but I also want to try to lift these two examples of the disk and the interval. So this is the first way you see that intervals can be lifted to ellipses. Okay. Good. So zeros, already Anna earlier today introduced the zero counting measure. So we take the n zeros of Tn, counting multiplicities, and we put a lot of masses and normalize this into a probability measure. So on the real line, you have alternation and all the zeros are simple. But that's not always the case in the complex plane, as we will also see, and as we have already seen for the disk. What I will especially consider is possible limit points of these zero counting measures, and those I will refer to as density of Chebyshev zeros. Okay, so there are some cheap results for these zeros, because already we've proved that all zeros of the polynomials, this applies to other types of polynomials as well, of course, lie in the convex hull. And if you're outside the set, you won't have a lot of zeros either. So what this implies for us is that if you want to look for a density of Chebyshev zeros, it's always going to be supported within the polynomially convex hull. Okay. But I can say a little bit more about what possible limits can show up, because we always have root asymptotics. So this is in the book of Sarf-Totik on logarithmic potential theory, external fields. You have root asymptotics outside of the convex hull. So the Green's function that we have also seen a couple of times during this meeting will show up, as well as the capacity. So what this enables us to prove is that if you have a density of Chebyshev zeros and you look at the corresponding potential, then outside the polynomial convex hull, so in omega, the potential will coincide with the potential for the equilibrium measure. Mm-hmm. So this is just another way of saying that if I take the Baliás, push this limit point out of, at the boundary of the set, that's going to be equilibrium. Or if I push out each of these measures in my sequence and take the limit, that's going to converge to equilibrium. And this has also been known for quite some years. You will find it in work of Mascar and Saf from the early 90s. Okay. So I'm in the complex plane. So in the complex plane, you have a lot of freedom. You have a lot of different sets you can consider. And the first result here, due to Blatzaf and Simkani, is an explanation why I will exclude considering arcs. Because if the set is polynomial convex and has empty interior, then the limit is unique. It's the equilibrium measure. Okay. So this is a case I will not consider, because I want to have more, not more exotic, but I don't want that I just have one theorem that says what the limit is immediately. Okay. So rather than that, I will focus on domains like Jordan regions. Okay. So for Jordan regions, there is a result of Saf and Totik from 1990. And this result is basically telling us, it's formulated a little bit more generally here, but if you think of it for Jordan region, this result is telling us that the zeros stay away from the boundary if and only if the boundary is analytic. Okay, and they prove this by a suitable comparison with the Faber polynomials, where you have many more analytic tools, of course. So we have already seen two examples of Jordan curves, analytic Jordan curves, the circle and the ellipse. For the circle, all the zeros were situated at zero, and that's of course inside. And so is the equilibrium measure -2/2 for the ellipse. And these two are also examples of what's called electrostatic skeletons in the literature. So these are measures so that if you balance them, they will give you equilibrium, but they are supported on curves. nice curves inside the set. So what I want to turn the attention to now is something more general than circle and ellipse. So a circle is the most special case you can think of as a lemniscate. So all the points where a polynomial is in absolute value equal to a constant. And as I said, the ellipse you can think of as a Green's the level curve of the Green's function for the interval minus 2, 2. And we want to go beyond that. So let's start by looking at lemniscates. So these are curves of this type. Of course, the circle is an example, but if we want to go beyond that, instead of just having one point, we can pick two points, and by symmetry, we can take them to be plus minus one. Then you have a family of lemniscates. When I is one, this is a figure eight. When I is bigger than one, you don't have a crossing anymore, but you have something that looks like a peanut. And if I is less than one, it splits up in two parts. For lemniscates, certain polynomials, a subsequence of the Chebyshev polynomials are already known. So that's just the power of the polynomials. And here we have all the polynomials of even degree that immediately gives us a density of Chebyshev zeros. So the point matches minus one, the point matches one, and the average of those. Odd degree, no simple formula. And even degree, I mean, there's no R dependence. There is for the odd. But there's still some symmetry. We have a zero at zero. The polynomials might be odd. They have real coefficients and so on and so forth. And we were starting speculating about what you can say in this case. And if you're just very naive, you're thinking that, well, there is a zero at zero. Okay, so be it, that's symmetry. And then all the other zeros, they're probably gonna be quite close to plus minus one, right? Because these are polynomials that minimize of even degree. We have the minimizers there. So the odd degree, it shouldn't be that different. Mm-hmm. And perhaps this was also a little bit motivated by what Saf Totic writes in the paper. So they have the result for a Jordan curve analytic boundary. And they write that if you have more components or not just the disconnected interiors, that it seems likely that the zeros stay away from the boundary exactly when you have finite number of analytic curves. In any event, we couldn't really prove this. And then I started working with this with Olaf, and we computed. If you cannot prove it directly, you try to do computations. And for T3, we could compute the zeros. They're not that close to plus minus one, but okay. We could also get some rough estimation for T5. And it looked like the zeros moved a little bit further away. And then we couldn't really say much before Olaf one day showed up in my office and he showed me the following picture. So after seeing that, and even this, and we can go on further, we stopped believing that the zeros in any way approach plus minus one. It just does not seem plausible. So Olaf found a refined version of what Tang introduced as a complex Ramus algorithm. This was further refined by Fischer and Modasiski in the early 90s, and Olaf had made this a quite efficient tool for getting ideas of what we should expect for the zeros. So we no longer believe that these zeros are approaching plus minus one. Of course, we expect that they approach equilibrium, though technically we don't have a proof of that yet. Now this is the picture for the figure eight. You can also get pictures for the blue curves here. So these are Cassini ovals. And also in this case, it looks like that the zeros approach equilibrium on the boundary of these curves. So again, we have no reason to expect that the zeros are really staying away from the boundary. So this is a little. This was surprising to us. I have a picture here where we can look at the peanuts also. And for the peanuts, all we know is that in that case, the zeros really stay away from the boundary. But how far away from the boundary are they? And what the numerics is telling us is that the zeros always stay inside the figure eight. And here we even go up to degree more than 50. So they stay inside this this figure eight. And also this is appear to us to be the simplest case where you really have two different densities. You have the 2 points and then you have equilibrium. We can go a bit further to more general Lemnitz gates. So let me just show you a picture for Lemnitz gates that generated by 3 points. So these are of course also the zeros of T3, T6 and so on and so forth with higher and higher multiplicity. If I take other polynomials where the degree is not divisible by 3, I have T17, T25, T32. And let me now include the Lemnitz gate. So the Lemnitz gate, if you take the R big enough and you then decrease it inside, then at some point you will have the first crossing of the Lemnitz gate. And we suspect that that's really where the zeros want to go. Except for those degrees where the polynomials, the zeros sit at the breakpoints. Okay. So this is the picture we have for Lemnitz gates, and that generalizes the disk. We can also generalize the case of ellipses. So the idea of Faber of lifting from one interval to the ellipses, that was generalized to Fischer for certain sets of, consisting of 2 intervals. And we lifted this even further to finite gap sets, so finite union of intervals. But we can really only say something when all these intervals have rational harmonic measure. But in that case, if you have, say, a union of k intervals, tkn is more or less explicit. So the classical tn here is Chebyshev for an interval. And here's the picture. So these are 2 symmetrically located intervals. And on the left, the Xi even degree, and odd degree, the zeros are going out to the curve. And this picture is the same also for non-symmetric intervals if it is still what we call a period K set. And again, 2 different densities of zeros, equilibrium on the intervals and equilibrium on this curve with a crossing. We don't know if one can go beyond this to really say something for general finite gap sets, because in that case, there's not really much explicit and we don't even have a closed formula for the Green's function. On the other hand, these sets can of course be approximated. So we don't really know what applies in that setting. Okay, so let's go beyond analyticity. Let's go to piecewise analytic boundary. And here we have a result that says, roughly speaking, that if there's a corner, then let me formulate this theorem first. So if you take a small neighborhood of the curve, so that it has a part in inside and outside the set, then either you have quite a few zeros in that neighborhood, or the part of that curve is analytic. This should of course be understood in the sense that usual mathematics have both can occur as well. This confused us at some point, but that's of course how it should be understood. So what this means is that whenever you have a corner point on the boundary, at least this corner point is attracting the zeros. So let me show you some pictures. So here is a certain Yukovsky airfoil illustrating that in some cases it looks like the zero is only approaching one point. Now, for Faber polynomials, this is actually a theorem that you will find in recent work of Levenberg and Bilonsky, and there are lots of other Yukovsky airfoils studied in that paper. Could also be that the zeros are accumulating at more than one point. If you take an equilateral triangle, we suspected that the zeros would lie on the diagonals, and it looks very fine in the beginning, but after a while, the zero seems to leave these diagonals and probably approach the equilibrium. And again, this is what we know happens for Faber polynomials. As you can get out of work of Gaia, and it's also more explicit in the paper of Coilers and stuff. All right, a third example. Even though the theorem says that the zeros accumulate at these points, it need not be the most attractive point. So here is a cardioid that just have one bad point, and that's the place where the zeros do not really want to go. But once you have such an inward cusp or inward corner, or more generally a non-convex singularity, as Safin Stylianopoulos calls it, then it's actually a theorem that the zero counting measure converges to equilibrium. So this is expected. Okay. What if we go beyond? If we go to curves that are not analytic at all? Well, then the theory tells us that then every point on the boundary is in fact the limit point of zeros. So in that case, we conjectured, we were not able to prove, but we conjectured that then the zero counting measure probably should converge to equilibrium. So let's have a look at a curve that's nowhere analytic, and what's a better choice than the Koch snowflake? In the beginning, T1, T2, T3, you just have by symmetry all the zeros at zero. If a little higher degree, you can push out the zeros. The Koch snowflake has these the symmetry, right? You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And once you increase the degree one more, the zeros are just jumping out as far as they can. And if we move on, T16, still a fair amount of zeros inside. 17, well, they move out a little bit. And 18, they jump out to the boundary. 18 is divisible by 6. And this is more or less the picture that we see here, 29, 30, 31, an extra zero at the point. So it seems kind of reasonable that the zeros should converge to equilibrium. I mean, there are some zeros in the middle from time to time, but not too many compared to how many zeros we have in total. There is a recent example of Totic that tells you that our conjecture is actually not true. You can construct certain Jordan domains where you basically take limit of suitably chosen Lemnis gates where a lot of the zeros will stay away from the boundary, and that means that you have no chance of convergence to equilibrium. But even in that case, I still believe that there should be a subsequence convergence to equilibrium. Okay, but we don't have a proof of that. Okay, let me move on to talk a few minutes about the norms of the polynomials. So I now assume polynomial convexity. I also normalize so that I have capacity one. That means that I don't need these powers of capacity all the time. And what we want to understand is how the norm behaves. It's always bigger than one, and you always have root asymptotics, classical results of Seeger. And also in the complex plane, you have equality in the lower bound precisely when you have a Lemnis gate. Okay. The root asymptotic tells you that the norm cannot grow too fast, but even if it's bounded, what are the limit points? And also, when is the norm close to one? which is the theoretical lower bound. And this is fairly well understood on the real line. So on the real line, you have a better bound. It's bounded by two. We also know precisely when the norm converges to two. Totic showed us that this is precisely when E is an interval. There are also examples of very thin Cantor type sets where you have sub-exponential growth of any order you like. What we have also shown is that for homogeneous set, fat Cantor sets, even Per-Widom sets that were also mentioned in the very first talk of this meeting by Besonov, but not defined, and I will not define it here either, the norm is bounded. Okay. So actually in that situation, we can generically, so in most cases, you have some almost periodic pattern of these norms, and they fill up an entire interval. And this is true in almost all cases generically, but not for period K sets. So there you have a periodic pattern and not an almost periodic pattern. We have a very good picture of what's going on, but there's one question that has been bothering us for quite a while, and we don't know how to solve. If you ask me, I will tell you one thing on Monday and then the complete opposite on Tuesday. But we don't know if there is a set of measure zero so that the norms of these polynomials are still bounded. One could expect that Per-Widom is optimal, that it's bounded if and only if, but we don't really know that. Okay, let's go back to the complex case.
Jacob, you already approached the limit.
Yes, I am. I'm done in two slides, so I'll be quick. Mm-hmm. I'll be quick. So in the complex case again, there are two results I should mention on when the norm is bounded. So finite union of arcs and curves. No outward pointing cusp of the complement. I don't really understand why it shouldn't be the other way around, but I will discuss that with Wilmers, I guess. That's a case where it's bounded. This is finite unions, and even for quasi disks, so for the Koch snowflake, for instance, the norm is bounded. We don't know, but it would be quite interesting to know if there is a connected infinite compact set where the Chebyshev norms are bounded. This is the unbounded, sorry. This is the case for Faber polynomials, but norms of Faber and Chebyshev are not quite the same. But even if it is the case, then the norm cannot grow too fast. The norm is always bigger of log n. Andreevsky proved that. Okay, so very last thing I want to say is when the norm is as small as it could possibly be. For analytic Jordan curve, even less smoothness of the boundary, this is known. One could ask if it's possible to go further. We proved that for the figure eight, it still converges to one. So a crossing is not something that makes this break down, but it does break down if you have more than one component. And there are further results of Totic and Juditsky talking about the Lim Sup and Lim Inf, and we have unions of smooth curves and arcs. But if this is all smoothness, if we leave smoothness behind, then we know that there exist the Jordan regions, for instance, on certain types of Julia sets, where even though it's just one component, the norm does not converge to one. We have no idea how to control all the limit points, though. All righty. Yes, so that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for your talk. Are there any questions or comments? If not, let us thank our speaker.
And comment.
Comment, you have a comment. Okay, good.
No, we have a question, actually. There is a criterion which is due to Kolmogorov. It's mm-hmm. published around 46.
Yes.
It's a substitute of alternation Chebyshev alternation principles for the case of extremal polynomials for complex play yes. complex domains.
Yes.
And I wonder, you have mentioned complex Remes algorithm, and what is it based on? Because classical Remes algorithm is exactly building the alternation set step by step. It is building the alternation set for this.
It relies on Kolmogorov, of course. Yes.
It is based on Kolmogorov.
Yes.
Okay. And another question is, how stable is that? Because we know that a classical Remes algorithm, it faces lots of instabilities. And in fact, if you are using just merely double precision arithmetic, it is very unlikely that you will get a solution of degree higher than maybe 15, for instance. And you use, that's from in your talk, there are solutions of degree 30. So what is the length of mantissa that you used for the calculations?
It depends a little bit on the set, but I would say in most cases it's stable up to degree 30, 40, some cases even higher.
What is the accuracy of internal arithmetic that you use? Because for instance, some of your sets were actually fractals, like the Koch snowflake.
Yeah,
I think it should be a difficulty also.
If you go up to very high degree, yes.
Yes.
But that of course we approximate. I don't know what the precision is, but what I can say is that besides plotting the zeros, we also plot the norm, and to see if you have this regular pattern of alternation, and the second that breaks down, where we don't have a nice thing that alternates between and the curve. Is like the alternating curve should be. At some point, it breaks down, and that's where the algorithm cannot produce anything more.
It's very much on the choice of basis, I suppose. If you have a nice
high degree, is still a problem, I believe.
For high degree, that's a problem. Yes,
that's it. Okay, thank you.
So, any questions here? Comments, Andrei? Yes.
Jacob, the zeros look pretty similar to zeros of plane orthogonal polynomials. Can you comment on that?
I think they look more similar to Faber polynomials. but no, we actually haven't there. We haven't considered the link to planar orthogonal polynomials. So I don't really have much to say to that, but it might be that we actually should.
So we don't have questions anymore here in Sochi, and maybe
if there are no questions. So thank you very much again.